Good morning, everybody. I think this is a very wonderful subject, and I must congratulate the organizers to have a dedicated session on translations. As all of you would agree with me, that translation is an acute necessity of our times. In a multilingual, multicultural, multi-religious, multi-ethnic country, and also the world, the need for translations is all the time and everywhere. During the past 2 days, even in the small groups, we required Kiran Butkule to translate or give a gist of what Pundalik Nayakji read out in Konkani. We needed English subtitles for the Kashmiri films that were shown to us. We also had Bhai Mauzo speaking at the inaugural session in Konkani first and then in English. So we find that we can't do without translations. And from oral to written to visual, all kinds of literature require translation. They require, of course, literacy and translation. So our topic today is dilemmas of translation, and I also congratulate the organizers for having on the panel all the practicing translators. They have done a lot of work, and they, of course, each one has one's preferences of the language, of the kind of literature they would like to pick up, and what they would like to choose, etc. So dilemmas are, of course, many, right, from what to translate and what not to translate, to whether it should be literal translation or bhavanuvad or parakaya pravesh, as Pridhiraji had mentioned about writing itself. So should it be mere transference of language or transference of culture or idioms, etc., etc.? So while translating, one can't afford to live with dilemmas. One has to resolve and move on, because these kind of doubts and dilemmas become speed breakers. And they, we also find it very frustrating if we have to stop in between. So let us hear the experiences of our panelists today, what dilemmas they faced and how did they resolve them. So I would like to give brief introduction of each one of them in the beginning, and then of course we'll continue with the discussion. So here is Mrs. Rita Kothari. She translates from Sindhi and Gujarati into English, and she also writes academic articles on translations. She used to earlier work for a communication agency, and at present she is teaching at the IIT Gandhinagar. Her book Unbordered Memories are the translations of Sindhi short stories, and the one by Muhammad Daud Baloch, am I pronouncing correctly, title Oxen, is my favorite story. It's a very, very moving story of how even animals are affected when they hear a different language. Next to her is Astri Ghosh. She is half Norwegian, half Bengali. She grew up in Delhi, and she speaks in Hindi, Bengali, English, German, Urdu, and of course Norwegian. She translates from all these languages. And at present, she is translating Tagore's work. She retranslated actually children's poems also. Tagore's work, the famous one, Where the Mind is Without Fear, that poem all of us have read, she has retranslated it. So she'll be able to tell us why did she do that. She feels that Tagore's language is sanitized. She'll explain it further. I'm not going to reveal, although we shared all this. And she has also translated some portions of Adi Granth Sahib into Norwegian, which is a very, I mean, which is the religious book of the Sikhs, you know. Sitting next to her is Professor Neelja Maddu. She was teaching English literature in Kashmir University, and she started translating Kashmiri short stories into English, and it all started with the Kashmiri women's works. She has also written papers on Lal Ded, Habba Khatun, Rop Bhavani, and so on. And at present also she's translating, and she would like to bring Kashmiri literature into English so that we all have access to the rich treasures that exist there. And we were going to have Suresh Amonkar, but he didn't, for some reason he was not able to join us. So we are very happy to have Hai Mauzo, as he is popularly known, Sri Damodar Mauzo, who is the pillar behind organizing this festival. And he, of course, was our very important advisor when I was with the National Book Trust. Straight away start with our panelists sitting here. May I first of all ask Astri, because your everything sounds very fascinating, going from one language to the other and calling Tagore language sanitized. So why did you decide to retranslate Tagore, like even Tashir Desh and Dakar, like everything has already been translated, but now all his works are in public domain, so anyone can retranslate, and that is what she's doing. So may I ask, request Astrid to please say.
Tagore was translated 100 years ago or more.
The universe is still up. No, put on the... now it's better. Yeah.
Now it's okay. When Tagore was translated more than 100 years ago, then he was also concerned about reaching out to the rest of the world. And so things, what I object to is, in those translations, some of those translations, is that references to Indian specific things like names of gods or specific ceremonies and all were all removed. You know, so that if, instead of mentioning Krishna or Shiva or other god, you talk instead about the one God. Now that is not necessary. If I'm translating a book for Indian children, I don't have to remove all those references. So, for instance, in this poem that you referred to, he says the Bengali version is very different from the English version. That's in the Gitanjali that we all know and that we learned in the heart. Because it, in the end it says, let India awake, and in the version that we always learned, it was let my people awake, which made it a sort of an international poem, which the rest of the world would relate to. But I just felt, all right, but if I'm translating for Indian children, I can let the original references be there. And I also feel that in many of the translations of Tagore that have been done in the last few years, people are so much in awe of it that the English language that they use is not, it doesn't sort of correspond to the Bengali that was used. Because his Bengali was, he was very concerned with high Bengali versus low Bengali, or Sadhu Bhasha and the Jahid Bhasha. He didn't want he wanted people to use a simpler Bengali, and especially when you're writing for children, you don't need to use language which is, I mean, if it's play, it has to be a language which is the spoken word, not a language which is hard for them to say. So when his plays were translated, whoever translated them, you know, I feel that people are so much in awe of Tagore that the language that they use is not simple language, which correspond to the Bengali that he used. So that was my philosophy while translating to Bengali.
Thank you very much. Well, I would request Nija ji to share her experience, because you had medieval poets on whom you have worked, and that is also like ancient language, and I'm sure the present language in Kashmiri is different to some extent. So would you like to elaborate on that based on your experience?
It sounds strange, but who belong to the 14th century, her language is much more close to the spoken Kashmiri today than the poetry of Brahmavani, who wrote in the 18th century, which is a very Sanskritized, scholarly, highly learned vocabulary using poetry. So with Lakhdar, actually you have problems with the concepts, you don't have problems with language. But with Brahmavani, you trend into rather, you know, say difficult waters, because you have to understand the whole yogic practices and also the various stages one goes through in one's mystic pursuit. And you have to be kind of orientated towards that philosophy. But then, having grown up in the Kashmiri tradition, it wasn't very difficult really.
Yes, but then when you translate it into English, what kind of English you would like?
That's a good question. You see, as far as I am concerned, I have grown up with these two languages, Kashmiri and English, and there is for me one kind of English, and the kind of English I use depends on the kind of tone of that particular poem or ma. If it is a very simple, straightforward kind of a thing, then there is no problem at all. But when the metaphors become a little complicated, then automatically your language progresses to that level. And you have to be able to think in two languages simultaneously. That I find a very, that I find a skill, useful skill. That you have to think immediately that this is how it will sound in English. And then you sort of read it again, and if you're not happy, then you change your word here. Otherwise, the first, first thing that comes to you when you read the original, if it comes to you in English, I think that is the right response. First, if you labor over it, then make a mess.
But then, in the medieval period, we found poems had a rhyming in it.
That is something which I don't attempt to do. But I maintain the rhythm. And I maintain the meter. I don't try to write it, but the meter is the same. For instance, Lakhdar's verses have a four-beat thing. There are four verses. Originally, they might have been two, because they were recited mostly, but in the written form, the stanza is four lines. And each line has four spaces, four accents. It's a kind of an iambic thing. And that is what I try to maintain in the English version. Length of the line and the meter, but I know. And Lakhdar is also a bit, you know, she's not very always writing. Maybe there are distortions, I don't know what the authentic version is, but in many of the other marks, you know, verses, you don't find rhyme.
Thank you very much. May I request Rita ji to share her experience of translating Sindhi, because also, like from one Indian language to the other, like most of us have found it easier than going into English from an Indian language. And she has been translating Gujarati poets into English, and also Sindhi short story collection that I spoke about, that also she has translated into English. So would you like to share with us, like, did you find these kind of speed breakers that I spoke about?
Varshaji, I'll take a little liberty here, and I want to move at least my discussion beyond the autobiographical mechanics of different quote-unquote dilemmas and difficulties I've faced.
That will be in the second round, perhaps. I thought initially let us share our
I think
experience.
My experience of translating Sindhi was built upon
my earlier experience of translating from Gujarati. The difference, of course, was the fact that Sindh was away from me. It was an inaccessible land, available to me only through my past, through the fact that my parents came from Sindh. But the descriptions, if you like, of the topography of the land, certain kinds of idiomatic usage, were require a different challenge than the ones that Gujarati did. I live in a Gujarati household, so it was much easier in some sense to have that accessibility to say whether this register works at a colloquial level or does it work at, if you like, at a more, what she mentioned, as a Sadhu Bhasha level. Sindh had a different set of difficulties. And yet Sindhi was my mother tongue. So in that sense, I mean, Gujarati was my husband's tongue. It's a house that I walked into after marriage. So then in some sense, there are these strange equations that these languages come to occupy within us. Your Hindi, your Sindhi, your Gujarati, English, they all have dynamics going on within you. And what happens during an act of translation, what kind of justice do you think you are doing to that part of your life is a very, very different matter. I think I want to sort of talk to you about maybe some of the different stages, if you like, of the different different challenges with, for instance, when we were translating a poet like Niranjan Bhagat from Gujarati into English. Now, you tend to think that translation is what follows the original, but translation also constitutes the original. Niranjan Bhagat is an extremely modernist poet, formed through influences of T.S. Eliot, Auden, Baudelaire. He's, in some sense, translating him was bringing modernity back home, right? You were bringing him back to where he belonged in English. Similarly, in the earlier work, when we were doing modern Gujarati poetry, the dilemma was not so much about how do you translate this or that, but what do you do with large, all-embracing worldviews. For instance, there was a ghazal by Ramesh Parikh called Na Thaya, matlab ki nahi hua, and where every radif spells out a proposition, and the kafiya shows you how difficult it is to stay with that proposition. So he says how humne haath phoolon mein dubo diye, lekin humare haath sugandhit nahi hue. Haath phoolon mein jaboriya toh suwana na thaya. We came so close to something, and yet it turned out to be a mirage. It wasn't available to us. And it builds up in this manner. And the last line says, Aaje varsad nathi em na kehta Ramesh. Aaje varsad nathi em na kehta Ramesh. Em kauf nashe. Apne bina na thaya. You know, aaj barish nahi hai, ye mat kehna, hogi, shayad hum gile nahi hue. So, whom are you to blame for this? And in a certain, if you like, Indian philosophical manner, the subject is missing, the responsibility is missing, the blame is missing. There is a passive construction by which you are not saying God did this to you or that I did this. How do you then create that missing subject in the English language? You know, these are actually, so sometimes it's, I think when people talk about the dilemmas of translation and we tend to list museum items, like how do you translate culture-specific words, increasingly people have begun to curate those in the glossary to say these are the museum items, so let's say this is, I think the discussion needs to sort of go beyond those items and to say what are these worldviews and what do we do with them.
How do you select what you would like to translate?
Well, friends, at the outset, we see in Kokri a Petlapitul. So my role here in this game is of playing a Petlapitul. It's like a stepney of the car. So I'm replacing Suresh Amargar, who is a great translator. I have translated, but not much. My experience is as a native writer. But I would like to share what is happening on the front of Kokri in the field of translations. Before I proceed, let me just make a small announcement here on behalf of the organizers. There is a slight change in the view of our multicultural, multilingual condition. We live in a multicultural, multilingual Goa. where people speak, everyone, almost everyone speaks more than three languages. We know Konkani is our language of the market. Everybody speaks Konkani, only Konkani. Then we read Marathi. Hindi is our national language, so we study Marathi, Hindi. We have fairly good knowledge. I'm talking about the average woman, fairly good knowledge of English. And besides that, we have, we know, there are people who know Kannada and Konkani people, since because of the diaspora of Konkani people, most of the Konkani speaking people in Goa and outside Goa, they know either Marathi or Kannada or Malayalam or Urdu, something of that sort. So in view of this, it's becoming more, we have, we face the biggest dilemma here. For whom we are, if we know Konkani and we know English, then if you read Konkani, it's enough. But so, our leadership is across Goa. But also at the same time, we have another dilemma. There are people who speak Konkani but do not read Konkani. So, I'll give you my example. I swear more in Goa English rather than Konkani. Though I do have a large leadership in Konkani also. But then, in certain sections, I am known because I am planning. So, this should not happen here. But unfortunately, it is happening. Then, other things we face is we have people who know good English, we have good command over English, but they are poor at understanding Konkani, literally Konkani, and also vice versa. So when it comes to Goa, the daughter's story by Maria Aurora Tutto, it was very difficult to translate it into Konkani. We couldn't find good translators. And same thing happens when Mahabeshwar Sai, a writer of great stature, when he needs a translator, we don't find, because it's very difficult to take culture across the language. I myself have recently written a novel on fisher folks, where you have different terms which are used in that trade, fishing business or fishes, for example. We know so many names of the fishes by heart, but it cannot be translated into English. So it's very difficult to take going to English or any other language also. I am one of the few who is lucky to get translated into many more languages than English and Hindi also. But my Tamil was of Sahitya, thanks to Sahitya Academy, is translated into nearly more than 12 languages in Indian language. But then, there are many writers of the stature of Pundalik Naik, whom we heard at the Governor's Palace. Then we have Ramesh Birushkar, which is a very good poet, but his poetry is based on folklore, you know, folk songs, which is very difficult to go into translation. We have Ramnath Gavde, who belongs to a rural area, who writes on mining and other things which are related to rural folk. Again, of course, this is not a dilemma faced by Konkani writers only, but this is one dilemma we face. People who have good command over English, but who can be counted as translators, they live in urban areas and they have no command over the local culture, I would say, to take it into English. So these are some of the dilemmas that we face in Konkani. But I must say, I must admire Suresh Amarkar, in spite of his sicknesses that he has come across, and in spite of his age also, he has done tremendous work in the field of translations. First, he has translated Dhammapad. I'm very happy that because Dharmanand Kosambi belonged to Goa, I am very proud of that, but it has been taken into Konkani now. So, Dhammapad, he came out first, translated into Konkani. Then he went for the Bhagavad Gita, which is translated into Konkani, Samashloki. Very important. Then he went for a Punjabi religious book, and then Tirukural Malayalam classic has translated. No, not Tamil. Punjabi also. Tirukural is Malayalam.
Tamil.
I'm sorry. That's very good. So sorry. Tamil classic in Konkani, and Punjabi I forgot the name. And then also present, then he translated Bible also into Konkani. And right now he is working on a translation of Thomas Kipper's book, famous Krishna Puran, into comedy. Again, keeping the same letter and using the same old comedy. So this is one work which needs recognition, because it's very difficult. Nobody votes for the old classics. People, everybody wants to translate either a Vishnu Party or people who are known now. That both ways, we are very happy that we have many books getting translated thanks to Sahitya Academy and National Book Trust. But at the same time, quality translations are doubtful, and sometimes they are under translated. So the writer is not very happy. Sometimes over translated. So again, the writer remains unhappy. These are the dilemmas we face.
You're very right, because I also faced it in the National Book Trust. It was very difficult to find translators who knew both the languages very well. And after they have translated, to find a reviewer also who knows both the languages very well. So it is definitely a problem. And we do need direct translators. Like we don't have anyone who can translate from, say, Punjabi to Gujarati. Like that, there are many such combinations. What is Astri, your view on translating from, say, a Gujarati work which has been translated into Hindi and then to take it into Norwegian or something?
So I think you know that dilemma of doing a third language translation is one that happens a lot, because it's not everybody knows all the languages. So when literature from India gets translated to a Scandinavian language, you have to go that way. But I prefer not to do that. Obviously, to translate directly into the language that we know. And I think that it's a luxury that if you find translators who know those languages. But for most publishers who don't have that luxury, they go that. And every translation is like one generation, you lose something. I'd like to mention, I once went to a performance of A Doll's House, Ibsen played, and I work on a project translating Ibsen. We are 8 translators around the world, and we meet twice a year, and we're going through the same thing, we're translating into all kinds of different languages. So I work especially we're translating 12 languages. But this is a performance I went to about 10 years ago, or more than that maybe, when a play, A Doll's House, had been translated from Norwegian to Russian to German, and from that German to Bangla, and from Bangla to Now, along that journey, some things have changed a lot. For instance, in this play, there is a dance called the Tarantella. Now, along the way, that tarantella had become another dance, it had become a flamenco, right? But from a flamenco, by the time it came to the version that I saw in Kiran's entertainment, it had become a flamingo dance. So, and there were several things like that, where the whole mood of the play changed, you know. So I feel that when we, now in a more global world, we have more people learning languages, and we don't have to have these 5 generation translations anymore, and necessarily, and so we're privileged. We don't have those kind of things. I find, for instance, when I'm translating Ibsen, this whole thing registered is a difficulty, because Ibsen was very much in the Christian, I mean, he was negative to it, not always positive to it, but he used a very biblical language. And all the swearing is also biblical. So and he uses it very, in a very consistent manner, and he thinks about it, you know, so he will have people who go out, you know, in Norway you don't swear according to your mother or your sister or whoever you might remember fondly, you talk about the devil, so mentioning the devil is wrong and mentioning God is wrong. And so when I translate that into Hindi, it's a problem for me because you know, that whole resistance does not exist. And so I was wondering, what do I say sala, do I say, you know, uluka patta, what do I do? And then I suddenly realized that no, but I can go to Urdu. And I can use the Muslim vocabulary, which is close to the Christian vocabulary. And in An Enemy of the People, you have this judge who's been translated as a mayor, but that's a wrong translation, he's actually a judge. Now I thought, all right, in the Indian system, Urdu was the language of the courts. So you have the judge, I'll give him an Urdu register. And then I let him say, you know, for that class, then I let him say, for that meeting and stuff like that, and then I just bring that in. And so I chose that, and so the other people I have this book is a more Hindi, and then a couple of the people there speak a more Urdu register, and that's how I did it.
That's a very good idea. I think we have to deal with several and choose. Neetaji, did you face anything like this? Because Kashmiri, I mean, I find that our local languages, our regional languages are very, very rich. But like my mouse just said, that there are so many names of fish which you don't find in English. Similarly, I'm sure there are certain expressions which you don't find in
another language. Actually, see, this is a situation that I encountered while translating short stories. Kashmiri vocabulary rich in abusive terms. And some of these abusive terms are connected to relationships. For instance, like in Urdu, you say sala.
Closer.
Is it better now?
Yes.
You see, you can't say brother-in-law and expect people to understand that it's an abusive word you are using. So there, of course, I did make some concessions, you know. But as far as the graphicness of the other abuses is concerned, I prefer to translate them into English, and I think the texture becomes sort of improved. And also, some of the terms, like he was giving the example of how many types of fish there are, those I leave alone, and I put them in italics, and I do have a glossary at the end. Because some of these things, they sound very nice even in English, in these words. So that's what I do. And another thing I wanted to say, that some of these older poets have been translated earlier. But why I did it is, again, you know, the question of register of things. For instance, they use the terms thou and thine and that kind of thing. So I thought that in the modern context, doesn't sound very nice, so I have a very direct way of approaching her readers. There is no nonsense kind of attitude. And she addresses people as, you know, somebody very close to her. Malya, actually Malya is a term of endearment in Kashmiri. So she has this closeness to the people she speaks. And I try to, you know, retain that in the kind of language I use in English. And also I don't add anything. I'm an extremely faithful translator, and in the case of living writers, sometimes before I publish, I send them the draft, and so far, touch wood, nobody has objected to what I have done, except, you know, one person once I got a great compliment from a writer, because there was something in the original which talked about the fellow being very lucky. So I thought that in English would sound better. I gave the expression of telling somebody, lucky dog. And he said, this is lucky, I like it very much, though it is not Kashmiri. But it expresses exactly, because the gentleman was well versed in English also. So that's what I do, and I approach it with a sense of humility. I don't want to be a creative writer when I'm translating. And I try to be honest.
Thank you very much. Would you like to add something to this, like being faithful and how much liberty one can take?
I don't know. I mean, if you look at the sort of indigenous native talent, I don't think it has been in the direction of faithfulness. It has been in the direction of invention. I think these notions about faithfulness and commitment to the text are also acquired ones. We are not in that tradition. We are in the tradition of adapting. We are in the tradition of reinventing. But it's not something you may choose not to do that as a translator, it's a different matter that I think when you look at, for instance, the Ramayans and the Mahabharats and its many versions and subversions, or you look at Shakespearean translations in India and so on, that is the tradition we come from. And there is a lot of grey bazaar out there where bestsellers are constantly being adapted very beautifully. But I agree with Nirjaji, as a translator, you don't do that because you think that this is not, you don't have a right to do it. That this does not, it's not your property, it does not belong to you. So just as you would try and report whatever somebody else says as verbatim as possible, you would try and keep that standards in translation. Although, as I said, I'm more than aware of the fact that philosophically that's not where we come from. Now, I was translating a Dalit novel. I mean, some of the issues about abusive registers and so on with Astri and Nirjaji have mentioned, it's Joseph McCown writes in an extremely abusive register very often. I translated that with great relish. Sometimes I did it with using English, sometimes I did it using the original Gujarati swear words because they were extremely powerful and they were raw and you don't want to turn things into, you know, eater of salt or whatever Mulk Raj Anand did when he wanted to say Namak Haram. So you don't want to do that. You sound quaint when you do that. So you don't. I don't think there is always any one principle that stays with you through the text. I think it is a very case-to-case response you make. So at some point you think it is all right to use English here. There are times when you think you don't want to use English here. You want to use the Gujarati or Sindhi or whatever. I must also give you an example since you asked me earlier about the Sindhi translation. There's a particular story, for instance, in that collection which is called Holi. And this Holi refers to both Holi as in sacred, H-O-L-Y, and it also refers to Holi as in H-O-L-I, the festival. Now, in English the spelling is different, but the Sindhi story plays upon this word in a very interesting way. That you've got this little boy who's called Holi by his grandfather. The grandfather commemorates his memory of a Sindh when Hindus and Muslims celebrated the festival together. And it is in the commemoration of that particular syncretic moment that he names his grandson as Holi, as in H-O-L-I. The Christian teacher in the school says, "What does your name mean?" He says, "I don't know, my grandfather named me." He said, the Christian teacher says, "Holy means sacred." This little boy comes to the grandfather and he says, "Is the teacher's holy different from your holy?" And the grandfather sort of gathers him in his arms and he says, "No, it is the same. It is the same holy. But my holy has disappeared. My friends have gone." And so it plays upon this nostalgia that the Muslim Sindhis felt in Pakistan when the Hindu Sindhis had left. Because something went out of their lives as well, right? In partition, we tend to focus upon the people who moved, but we do not look at the people who did not move. But their spaces were deprived by other communities who lived there, and there is an impoverishment of a certain sociology. So the story plays upon this word. Now, what do I do as a translator? Which spelling of holy do I use, and why? So the first instance, I had to use it with an oblique. And I don't know whether this is a resolution of translation. Perhaps it is not. But I'm comfortable with untranslatability. I'm comfortable with the idea that everything cannot be resolved. We can't be so arrogant as to say that all translation problems are problems that can be solved. I think it is important to say they cannot be. And you live with that untranslatability. That's an important gesture to make to a text. I do think that the more tethered a text is to a particular context, the more untranslatable it will be, and therefore the more deprived a target public sphere would be without that text. But that does not mean you try and translate everything.
I do think that you need a more, you need some humility and say some things cannot be done, and that's the way it should be. And you know, Walter Benjamin, when he wrote about translation, he wrote about that, about, you know, keeping keeping the foreignness in it, because you're bringing a foreign literature to someone else, but you don't translate everything, you can't translate everything, and it's not necessary to translate everything. You have to keep that feeling of this is something else that is coming to you.
See, I want to say that there are certain very graphic proverbs in Kashmiri language. I prefer to translate them literally, and because I feel that it is good for the other language also to acquire some new terminology.
Could you give us some examples?
Who is asking this question? I'm such a woman. I wanted to be sure whether it's a Kashmiri asking.
I know one Kashmiri term of abuse. I'm wondering if you're going to say that. I'm not brave enough to say.
I don't think that's what it is.
Okay, you can say that.
This is all the literary people full of abuse. Yeah.
Come on, be daring. And of course, we have been talking about abusive words.
Yeah. Many friends used to tell me that the worst bit of abuse they knew was Baji Lazme Momarkanda.
That cannot be translated. That is something very bad.
You can easily get a sentence starting with an F.
But I think this has nothing to do with, this is not part of a culture.
No. That's the kind of thing.
Can be translated in any culture.
So I'm just telling you that these are the kind of, things which are maybe, unfortunately, I haven't encountered.
I don't know who is this man who has told you.
But this is not part of culture.
You know, for instance, you are thinking of proverbs.
I want you to know some proverbs.
Problems now. Can somebody suggest a problem to
me? This was not a Kashmiri, it was damn full of this thing.
Kashmiri, as far as I know, many Kashmiri friends.
Just a linguistic structure. Just a linguistic structure.
You went out just now.
Maybe this Madhavani Nosha
Sadrai also. Oh, yes. That is correctly. When a lunatic family acquired a daughter-in-law, she turned out to be madder than all the rest of us. So that's the way I'm translating a thing like this. And it doesn't sound bad in English. Fortunately for me, I have not had these dilemmas.
This is not normal.
Kashmiri language.
We were discussing while you were out.
No, abuse.
Let me share my experience here. You know, this is the translator's dilemma. We have excellent proverbs in Konkani, like Jivaslar Bhikmagul Khao. Jivaslar Bhikmagul Khao. If my life is safe, doesn't matter. As long as I am alive, I can go back and eat and survive. It is the same. So when it translated Sar Salamat to Pagdi Pachas, it carries the meaning, but then the local flavor is not carried. So this is also a translator's dilemma. Particularly those who translate into English, they look out for the proverbs and sayings in England, existing in England or America, which do not suit here. And also, I would like to say, we have a tradition, particularly in the rural areas, to speak with bad words, which are considered as bad words by others. Even a mother will shout at child with starting with the F in Konkani. But then you cannot translate into English. If you want to take the culture or the seriousness of the discussion or dialogue, then we should not hesitate. I personally feel in one of my stories where the son is so much abuses the parents, finally the day comes when he gives a bad word to his father, starting on, I mean, in terms of motherfucker. Now, this is common in comedy. And it leads to seriousness. How serious it is, the son calling the father in front of his mother as mother's fucker, then we should translate it into English. But the translator, then you know, when he translated it by translation, by writing in Comedy itself, I said, mother Khaya. Khaya is mother eater. But it is not so. So the seriousness line is lost. So this is the dilemma of a writer also.
Actually, when I was moving in the rural areas of Orissa for a literacy program, I was told by one of the adults who didn't want to get into the studies, and he said something in Oriya that Chattu Kuta Katha, Nissa Kuta Patha, that doesn't work. Means the wood where mushroom has grown and studies where the mustaches have grown, they don't work. Now this is something you can't translate.
Why not?
So I had to use it. No, I mean, I can't translate into Gujarati. Suppose I'm writing in Gujarati, I only have to paraphrase it or explain it in words. But the way it rhymes and the way it conveys the meaning, which is like it hits the nail, you know. So certain things are untranslatable. I fully agree. Actually, we all translators who have been working and struggling, we do realize that everything can't be translated.
Okay. There are some concepts which we can neither translate nor can we leave it in the original. For example, what is common in the subcontinent, we will all understand the word jutha or ushta. You can't keep it as it is in English because the English reader can't understand it. And it's a word that can't be translated because that concept is not known. Even within Indian languages, we find, for example, Marathi to Hindi, I cannot translate Panta Ala or Vaaz Ailo. I can use Boreal, but it's not, it doesn't mean the same thing.
Sometimes I think we are so attached to our word that we don't want to take any liberty also. That I have felt that no, I just can't translate this. But if I think about it and, you know, maybe I can come across, sometimes we don't come across, that is also okay.
Actually, I solve it by writing two or three sentences.
Actually, we are very subjective about it, and all translators are, and they should be, because ultimately it is their own judgment which will count when they render it into another language. Yeah, please.
Sometimes there are in-between meanings, also do exceptions. Sometimes they are not, you know, you cannot translate it into your own language.
Peters or Dominicus have, or Domingos have become Dominics. It carries no sense for the people across Goa. But it shows that Portuguese have gone and the English has come. You know, Pedro has been replaced by Peter and Domingo is replaced by Dominic. For Goa, you don't have to explain. Whereas for the rest of the place people, we have to add a line that since the Portuguese rule is over, the people have changed their names to, you know, so if some addition is required in such cases.
There must be situations like this in other cultures also. So you find,
yes. There is a question here. Yes, please.
Yeah, my question is
I think also you have to make the judgment of not underestimating the intelligence of your leader. Sometimes I think that we do not have to explain everything.
My question is that what tools and techniques writers use to translate this cultural dissimilarity? For example, there are two separate socio-cultural contexts. In one culture, we have something, and that's entirely missing from another this culture. What tools and techniques writers and poets use?
I would request Harish Ji to take up this question, because he is into that domain.
Actually, what I wanted to do was to congratulate the panel on the extremely high level of discussion and on the most dignified language used. I do not know how it is when it comes to translation. Sale, Haramzade, Motherfucker, iske niche baati bhi hoti hai. Ye kya kya baat hai? Isi pe sab focus rahega kya? Ek dusri baat main kehna chahta hu. So what do we focus on? These are very simple terms to explain the intent behind them. If we go literally after them, then of course, you know, we run into all kinds of absurdities. And also, if translation is always talked about in such highly empirical terms, once I came across this problem, and at other time I came across this problem, we are not going to have any kind of generalizable, valid formulation about it. It turns into a gossip session immediately. I'm not saying that I do not do it. Everybody does it. But in a discussion, in a largely attentive discussion like this, the one problem that I wanted to put on the table was, why are we so obsessed about translating from all our languages into English, which is not even our own language? That explains half the problems. It seems to me that there is a tremendous amount of, it doesn't seem to me, Varsha Ji knows this better than anybody at the National Book Trust, even more so at the Sahitya Academy, there is so much translation going on between the Indian languages. And the problems, it's not that there are no problems there, the problems there are of a different kind. And at a festival like this, which is usually multilingual, I think some of that should be brought forward to compare. The impulse to translate into English is sometimes not a very worthy impulse. And also, we do not wait for them to come in translators. We translate ourselves and go begging to them for attention. This is a very unequal kind of situation. Always, one golden rule of translation is translate into one's mother tongue. How many of us think that English is actually our mother tongue? It may be our first language. Let them translate us and do what they like with it. Why are we going begging and supplicating? Let's focus on translation amongst our own languages.
So that faithfully one can do it, how interestingly one can do it, etc. I mean, that depends on each translation.
Actually, you see, the problem with our language Kashmiri is that there are people who have lived in Kashmir for years and years and not picked up a word of the language. And we feel that these are people who are, I don't have the skill to translate it into any other language. And this is the only way that these short story writers, their work was translated into other regional languages. From, see, the Sahitya Academy published one volume, and it is out of print now. But it's been translated into many regional languages. So that's the only way they had access. I'm very sorry to say that Kashmiri is one language which no one has really taken the trouble to learn. There are people, as I told you, who lived for generations, never picked up a word of Kashmir. That was my reason. Thank you.
Yeah, I just wanted to make, actually, at the beginning, a small intervention, which is that we focused a lot of attention, not just in this panel, but generally on the fact that it is a multilingual society, and therefore translation is necessary, and there is an acute need for translation and all that. But I think there's very little discussion, and this is not only Indian languages translated into English, but even Indian languages translated into other Indian languages, which is the multilingualism of a text. For instance, there is an embedded multilingualism in many texts, which, whether you translate that into Hindi or Marathi or English, you do not get those several languages the target language has to be one language. And I think that is a very, very fundamental, if you like, dilemma of translation. For instance, if you're, even if you look at Amir Khusro, his famous line, Zihale Miskin Makum Tawaful Varai Naina, the first line is in Persian, the second is in Bridge. When you look at, you see, there's no novel, there's no poem we read which is only entirely in Kashmiri or only entirely in Gujarati. It has been constituted in overt and covert ways by other languages also. So this Dalit novel that I was talking about, there is a character called Master who's already a character in translation. He lives in the village. He has been formed by Gandhian and Ambedkarite philosophy. He knows English, so everybody calls him Master. That character has already been formed through a certain form of cultural translation. So therefore, when you were to subject that text to a target language, it is likely to turn that into a monolingual exercise. And therefore, sometimes when people think translation is does service to a multilingual society, I think sometimes translation does disservice to a monolingual text.
I want to say something.
Yes, please. See, as far as I'm concerned, I have a lot too much money out of it. And I did it not because somebody had asked me to do it, but I did it because I felt like doing it. And most of the time, whatever I did, I didn't get paid for it. In fact, I was very surprised once when I saw a textbook in the J&K Board of School Education, which had a Kashmiri short story translated into English as part of its elective English course. And it was my translation and everything, and there was no credit, no mention, no name, nothing. And I thought I would protest, and I wrote them a letter, but nothing came of it. So many times my translations have been used by people, I wouldn't like to name them, without giving credit at all. And these are people, unfortunately, I don't feel, I didn't feel so bad, because the original author was also not given any credit. In one case, in a commercial enterprise. So I don't want to blame it, but this is what happens. So money, I don't think there is much money. You do it because you feel like doing it. That's my case.
I think that you don't, when you say a creative writer writes because he has the urge to write, I think as a translator as well, some of us sometimes people tell me, you know, it's best that you have one mother tongue and you're good in your one mother tongue. But I grew up in a home where we spoke four languages. We didn't have the choice. I never had that choice or luxury of having one mother tongue. And the point is that when you are multilingual and you see something and you think, that would be, how would that be like this? And you don't start. It's that same creative urge I write as well. But the point is that you start thinking about it and you're not thinking about the money. I mean, most of the work I've done takes years and years. Translate from the Guru Granth Sahib was like very, very difficult work. It took a long time. You're very scared of making mistakes, you know. What you get in terms of money, that's a symbolic sum, right? But what you're actually doing, it's a labor of love. And with whatever you do, and what you get from the publisher, you should get, you're working, you should get. But it's a symbolic sum. You have to do something else to put bread butter on the table.
I agree with Asri. That has been my experience also. You become so passionate about translating when you know more than one language that you do want to take it somewhere else. I think I'm afraid we have to close now.